Sai Ram, welcome back to the class on Microbes in Human Welfare. In the last class, we spoke about microorganisms and their uses in household products and industrial products. Today, we are going to discuss their use in sewage management, in biogas production, as biocontrol agents and biofertilizers. So before we go to the topic, let's see the answers for the questions we had in the last part. What is inoculum? We spoke how we take a spoon of curd and mix it with milk and turns into curd. So that is inoculum. The sample of curd that is added to milk is inoculum. Next is, what is the organism involved in fermentation? Lactobacillus is the organism. It releases lactic acid, which will break the milk protein. What gives puffy appearance to the fermented batter? Release of carbon dioxide. The puffed up appearance of the batter is because of release of carbon dioxide. Saccharomyces cerevisiae is also called by two names. Mention the names. What is Saccharomyces cerevisiae? It's a yeast. It is used both in baking and brewing. When it is used in baking, it's called baker's yeast. And when it is used in brewing, it's called brewer's yeast. What is toddy? Toddy, we spoke about it. It's a traditional drink where the sap of palm trees is fermented. Name the three scientists to whom Nobel Prize was given for discovery of penicillin. This we spoke under antibiotics, how Alexander Fleming accidentally discovered penicillin, and then Ernest Chain and Howard Florey joined him to establish it as a potent drug. So all three of them were given Nobel Prize in 1945. Acetic acid is produced by, what is acetic acid? Acetic acid is vinegar. It is produced by Acetobacter acetae. It is used as a cleaning product, cleaning agent. Next is pectinases and proteases. What are pectinases and proteases? They are enzymes. They act on pectins and proteins. They are helpful in removing the pulp from fruit juices, especially used in bottled juices. Next is cyclosporin. Cyclosporin we spoke about under bioactive molecules, which can change the metabolism. Cyclosporin is used as immunosuppressive agent. Where is it used? It's used in organ transplant. So these are the answers for the questions. Let's move on to the topic for today. Uses of microbes in sewage treatment. So we are going to talk about sewage treatment. What is sewage? Sewage is municipal waste water. What does it contain? It contains organic matter, especially human excreta. So can this water be mixed in water bodies like rivers and streams? No, because they contain highly pathogenic bacteria which can cause diseases. So this water has to be treated first in sewage treatment plant. So what they do, they collect all this wastewater in huge pipes, take them to a sewage treatment plant. There the water is treated and purified. Then the water is taken to water bodies like rivers and streams. What do they use in treating the sewage? They use microbes, right? They use microbes to treat the sewage. So let's see how it is done. The stages of sewage treatment. The first stage is called primary stage. There are two stages. The first stage is called primary stage. The second stage is called secondary stage. So the first stage is physical stage. What does this mean? As the water enters into the sewage treatment plant, all that is physically seen is being removed. Water physically seen, there's floating debris and there is grit. Floating debris, as the water enters, all the debris that is physically seen, like plastic covers, papers, the cloth pieces, water bottles, all these are removed. How is the floating debris removed? It is removed by sequential filtration. They have this huge filters which stop all this debris which is floating. And then the water goes for grit removal. What is grit? Grit is nothing but soil and pebbles. How is this removed? As the water enters into a tank, all that is heavy is settled down by a process called sedimentation. As the heavy things settle down, all that is remaining is just the liquid. So as the heavy things settle down, they are soil and grit, soil and pebbles, which consists of grit. So grit is removed, floating debris is removed in the first stage, that is primary treatment or physical treatment. After this, whatever is left over is called effluent. What is effluent? It is nothing but the waste water with organic matter. All that is not organic matter, the debris, the grit, the pebbles, everything is removed in the first stage, that is physical stage, where physically whatever is visible is removed. Then let's move on to the second stage or biological stage. This is how a sewage treatment plant looks like. Though it looks a very complex picture, it's very easy to understand. As I told before, the first stage is physical stage. Here the waste water is entering, and this bar screen is nothing but the filter. It is stopping all the big floating debris, like large rubbish pieces, plastic bottles, everything is stopped here. Next, the water is taken into a settling tank. Here all the grit is removed by sedimentation. Then the water goes into first sedimentation tank. Any leftover grit, any waste material, floating debris is being settled down here. So from A to C, this part is the physical part. Okay, the physical part is from here to here. And next, from this, from the aeration tank to the digestive tank, it is the biological part. This part is the biological part. So we have physical part and the biological part. Why is this called biological? Because microbes are added here. All right, see, first the water goes here, floating debris is removed, then the grit is removed. Right now here the water is containing only the organic matter. So this water which contains organic matter is called effluent. Now the effluent is taken into aeration tank. Here starts the biological process, biological treatment. Aeration stands with A, it starts with A. In aeration tank, two things are added. One is air, another is aerobic bacteria. Okay, in the aeration tank, two things are added. What are they? Aerobic bacteria and air. So what does the aerobic bacteria do? Aerobic bacteria will try to eat up all the organic matter that is present in the effluent. First they add aerobic bacteria, then they add air, then they constantly agitate this aeration tank. As the aeration tank is agitated, it forms something called flocks. So what are flocks? Flocks are nothing but this aerobic bacteria which will form colonies with mesh-like structure. The whole aeration tank is filled with mesh-like aerobic bacterial colonies which are called flocks. And as they form flocks, they start eating up this organic matter. So what bacteria did we add? Aerobic bacteria. What do they require? They require oxygen. Isn't it? Aerobic bacteria will respire using oxygen. So to consume the organic matter, they require oxygen. That's why we are adding air here. And they eat up the whole organic matter. From the aeration tank, the water is taken to second sedimentation tank. So in second sedimentation tank, all the organic matter is already removed. So here we want to check the purity of the water. How do we check the purity of the water? There's something called BOD. What is BOD? Biochemical oxygen demand. So how much oxygen has been consumed to remove the organic matter is checked here. If the organisms require more oxygen, that means there's more organic matter present there, isn't it? If there is no organic matter, no oxygen required. Once the oxygen consumption is zero, or the BOD is zero or minimal, that means the water is purified. Once the water is purified, it is sent to rivers or other water bodies. And then whatever is sedimented here, what sediments here? The flocks of bacteria. This activated sludge is nothing but the aerobic bacteria. Okay, the flocks or the colonies of aerobic bacteria is activated sludge. So what do we do with the aerobic bacteria now? Can we leave them like that? No. So we take this aerobic bacteria into the digester tank. And to eat up these aerobic bacteria, we have to add something, isn't it? What is that? Anaerobic bacteria. We add anaerobic bacteria here. Aerobic bacteria are taken here and anaerobic bacteria are added to digest them. In this process, they release a lot of gases like carbon dioxide, hydrogen sulfide, sulfur, methane. This is nothing but biogas. Okay, as anaerobic bacteria start eating up the aerobic bacteria, they release biogas, and whatever is left over, the bio waste, is nothing but manure. So that completes the process of sewage treatment. Let me quickly go through this once again. From A to C, we are removing the floating debris and grit. That is the physical stage. Okay. And from here until the digester tank, it is biological stage. In aeration tank, we added two A's, that is air and aerobic bacteria. The aerobic bacteria eats up all the organic matter. In this process, they consume oxygen. And the purified water is checked for BOD. If there is no more oxygen consumption required by the bacteria here, that means the water is clean. And whatever settles down is the activated sludge, which is nothing but the aerobic bacteria. The aerobic bacteria are taken into digester tanks. Anaerobic bacteria act on them, release biogas. And whatever is left over is manure. So in a sewage treatment plant, we are not only cleaning up the water, not only purifying the water, we are also producing biogas and manure. So here again we have a flow chart talking about the biological treatment part so that it is easily explainable to you. What is effluent? Effluent is the wastewater that contains organic matter. All the floating debris and grit has been removed. This effluent is taken into aeration tank. Here it is constantly agitated by adding aerobic bacteria and air. Air for aeration, air for aerobic bacteria and air. After agitation, it forms flocks. What are flocks? Colonies of bacteria, and then they eat up the organic matter. In this process, they consume oxygen, and the reduced BOD of the effluent is being checked. After this, the effluent is taken to the settling tank, and then by sedimentation of flocks, activated sludge is formed. Pure water is sent to river and other water bodies. Then they are taken to digester tanks. The activated sludge is taken to digester tanks. In the digester tanks, anaerobic bacteria will eat up the aerobic bacteria. In this process, they release gases like methane, hydrogen sulfide and carbon dioxide, which is nothing but biogas. So that is about the biological treatment. The first was physical treatment and the second was biological treatment. First is primary, second is secondary. There are only two steps in the whole treatment of sewage. I hope it is clear to you. Next is biochemical oxygen demand. This is one of the most important questions in sewage treatment. As such, sewage treatment is a very important topic. In that, a short question is biochemical oxygen demand. We spoke how aerobic bacteria eats up this organic matter. And in that process, they require oxygen because they are aerobic bacteria. So, the amount of oxygen that is required to completely eat up this organic matter in 1 liter of the effluent is biochemical oxygen demand. Very simple to understand how much oxygen is required, all right, to eat up or to oxidize the whole organic matter in 1 liter of effluent. So if the organic matter is too much, if the water is too polluted, if the organic matter is so much, they require even oxygen at a higher levels, right? If the oxygen is taken at a lower level, that means the organic matter is less, the water is less polluting. So how do we check for the purity of water? Once the BOD is minimal or BOD is zero, that means the organisms do not require oxygen. That means there is no organic matter. So if the BOD is minimal, that means water is pure. That is about biochemical oxygen demand. So that's about sewage treatment. Next we are moving to production of biogas. So what is biogas? Biogas is a combination of gases. It contains carbon dioxide, it contains sulfur, it contains hydrogen, it contains methane. But the main gas here is methane. Alright? So how is this produced? This is produced by anaerobic bacteria. When they act on cellulose, methane is produced. And these anaerobic bacteria are called methanogens. Because they produce methane, they are called methanogens. And the common bacteria are methanobacterium. Where are they present? The methanobacteriums are present in digester tanks of sewage system. We spoke about this in sewage, how biogas is produced in sewage plant. So they are present in sewage plant digester tank. And they are also present in the rumen of cattle. Why rumen of cattle? What do cattle eat? They eat grass. What is grass? It is cellulose. So to digest this grass, they need this methanobacterium or methanogens. That is the reason methanogens are present in the stomach of cattle. And because they are present in the stomach of the cattle, and as cellulose is digested by the cattle, they are also present in the excreta or dung of the cattle, which is the main thing that is used in the production of biogas. It is also called as gobar. It is used in the production of biogas. So biogas is what? It is methane. How it is produced? When anaerobic bacteria act on cellulose material. These anaerobic bacteria are called methanogens. Common bacteria is methanobacterium. So where is this methanobacterium present? In the stomach of cattle or in the digester tanks of sewage plant. Alright? So let's move on to the next. This is how a biogas producing unit looks like. Nothing very complex, very simple. This is influent. What is influent? What we put in is influent. Right? What do we put? We put dung, the slurry of the dung, which contains methanobacterium. And then we put some cellulose, right? Some bio waste. And all these are taken into the digester tanks. Digester tanks means there. The process here is digestion. All this are digested by the anaerobic bacteria. One important point here is floating cover. So this digester tank is covered by a floating cover. It doesn't have a cover that is tightened. What is the reason behind this is, as the anaerobic bacteria act on cellulose, the gas that is produced will keep moving this floating cover up. And with the pressure of the gas, the cover will keep moving up and it will reach a point where it is maximum. And then the cover is tightened. And through this outlet, the biogas is taken out. And what is remaining is effluent. What is remaining? The bio waste, which cannot be digested anymore. And this effluent is used as manure. So what did we see? We saw influent. What is influent? Methanogens, right? And then bio waste, we put that in the digester tank, and then there is this floating cover. As methane is produced and carbon dioxide and hydrogen sulfide, all the mixture of gases is produced, this floating cover moves up, and once it reaches the top, it is tightened, the valve is open to take the gas out, and whatever is left over is the bio waste, which can be used as manure or fertilizer. So where are these biogas plants present? They are usually present in rural areas. What is the reason? Because cattle are more in rural areas, right? So dung availability is more in rural areas. And for what is this gas used? It is used for cooking and lightening. Lightening up the streets and cooking, because it can take the place of firewood, which is more polluting. So instead of firewood in rural areas, biogas can be used. So that's about biogas. And then we can talk about microorganisms as biocontrol agents. What is biocontrol? Controlling another life, right? Bio is life, control is control. So where are they used? They are used as pest controlling agents. So usually crops are always affected by pests. And what do we use? We always use chemical pesticides which are harmful both for the plant and for the humans who take the yield from the crop. So what are the examples of biocontrol agents? They're beetles. Beetles eat aphids. For example, if a crop is affected by aphids, then what they do, instead of putting chemical pesticides, they put some beetles in there. So the beetle eats up the aphids and the pests are taken care of. Same way, Gambusia fish. Gambusia fish, they're put in the ponds and streams. What do? They eat up larvae and mosquito, so that there are no mosquitoes and larvae present. But are these microorganisms? No. We are talking about microorganisms as pest controlling agents, right? So the first here is Bacillus thuringiensis, very important. Bacillus thuringiensis is a bacteria and it affects, the pest affected is caterpillar. How does this work? Bacillus thuringiensis is available as a spore and it has been sprinkled in on the crops, right? So as a caterpillar comes and takes the spore in, or it eats the spore, it is mixed with its saliva and it enters into its gut. The spore enters the caterpillar's gut. There it releases toxins and kills the caterpillar. So that's how Bacillus thuringiensis works. So the first microorganism as biocontrol agent is a bacteria, that is Bacillus thuringiensis. But of late, because of genetic engineering, what they're doing is they take this gene of Bacillus thuringiensis and they introduce it into the plant itself when the plant has been made. So the whole crop is being resistant to caterpillar. If a caterpillar comes and eats a leaf of this crop, the crop is already resistant to caterpillar. It doesn't affect, the pest is killed because the gene is already present, right? Example for this is BT cotton. What is BT? Bacillus thuringiensis cotton. So cotton crops are usually affected by caterpillar attacks. In such cases, this Bacillus thuringiensis is useful. So let's see in the next one. The next is a virus. It is called baculovirus. Baculovirus is also one of the biocontrol agents. Baculovirus is from a gene nucleopolyhedrovirus. How does it act? Very important. It is a narrow spectrum insecticidal agent. What does this mean? For example, a crop is affected by multiple pests, right, or multiple microorganisms. But we have to kill only one pest because other pests are not harmful. Or maybe some of the pests are living on symbiosis. They're helping the plants. They're taking some nutrition from the plant and giving some other nutrition. So we are attacking only one particular pest. That is narrow spectrum. That is specific species only we are affecting. So how does this baculovirus work? It works by RNA interface. So what is this RNA interface? For example, this is the RNA. Okay, this is the RNA of the pest. All right. This baculovirus will go and make a RNA which is exactly similar to that of the pest. Okay, and then locks it. So as it locks it, the pest dies. Baculovirus, specific species is only attacked. The process is RNA interface. What is it? It makes a complementary RNA to that of the RNA of the attacking insect or the pest. Why do we use baculovirus as specific agents? To protect other pests. So to preserve the other pests. All other plants, mammals, birds, everything else is safe. Only that required pest is killed. So that's about biocontrol agents. What we spoke under biocontrol agents are Bacillus thuringiensis and baculovirus. One is a bacteria, another is a virus. Next, let's see about biofertilizers, microorganisms as biofertilizers. So what are biofertilizers? They are used in lieu of chemical fertilizers to increase the fertility of soil or increase the nutritional value of the soil. Usually chemical pesticides are harmful both to the plants and humans. And people are opting for organic farming. That is the reason biofertilizers are being used. What are biofertilizers? Bacteria, fungi, and cyanobacteria. The picture here shows it is a root nodule. So there is a kind of bacteria which is called rhizobium. This lives in the roots. Okay, let's see how does it work. So the first example of a biofertilizer is rhizobium. How does it work? It works by symbiotic association and fixes atmospheric nitrogen. So we saw the picture how it lives on the root nodules. So what does it do? It fixes the atmospheric nitrogen into the roots of the plants. All right, and in turn it takes the nutrition from the plants, that is symbiosis. It is giving some nutrition to the plant and it is taking in return. So they both are living in harmony. That is rhizobium fixing atmospheric nitrogen into the roots. The next one is azospirulum and azotobacter. So these live freely in the soil, all right, and they also fix atmospheric nitrogen. Rhizobium, it fixes nitrogen, and azospirulum also fixes nitrogen. Rhizobium lives in the roots, azospirulum lives freely in the soil. Next is fungi and mycorrhiza. What do? They absorb the soil phosphorus from the soil and gives it to the plants. This is the only one that absorbs phosphorus. Rhizobium and azospirulum, nitrogen. Fungi and mycorrhiza, phosphorus. And they also retain the moisture of the soil. Thereby, they increase the tolerance to salinity and drought. Because they retain the moisture of the soil, there is no drought and salinity. They have an increased tolerance to it. Right? Next is cyanobacteria and autotrophic microbes. What do these do? They are usually used in paddy fields. Cyanobacteria used in paddy field, important question. And how do they help? They also fix nitrogen. So among all the biofertilizers, rhizobium, azospirulum, cyanobacteria, all of them nitrogen fixing. Only one that is phosphorus is fungi and mycorrhiza. So that's about biofertilizers. So today we spoke about how microorganisms are helpful in sewage treatment, biogas production, as biocontrol agents, and as biofertilizers. So we have a question here for today's class. What are the two steps involved in sewage treatment? We spoke about how floating debris is removed in one step, and in another step how microorganisms are helpful. So name the two steps. What are added to the aeration tank? This I specifically mentioned. Aeration starts with A, and the two things that are added here also start with A. So that is the answer for that question. What is activated sludge? Once the water is purified and the BOD is minimal or zero, right? Then sedimentation of a certain thing is done, that is activated sludge. So what is that present in activated sludge? Then what is BOD? We spoke about BOD, how aerobic organisms require oxygen to eat up the organic matter. So the answer for BOD is in that only, this consumption of oxygen by aerobic bacteria. That is the reply for the BOD. What is the main gas produced in biogas? We spoke how biogas is a combination of gases, but the main gas is produced by methanogens. So what is that gas? Gene of which bacteria is introduced into the plants through genetic engineering? We spoke about this on biocontrol agents. We spoke of two things. One was a bacteria, another was a virus. So we are asking about a bacteria which will affect caterpillars. So what is the name of that bacteria? Which organism fixes atmospheric nitrogen into the root nodules of the plants? This is about biofertilizers, right? So we already saw the picture also, how this organism lives on symbiotic association. It takes something from the plant and gives in turn nitrogen. So what is that organism? So that is the end of the topic, microbes in human welfare. I hope you understood the topic well. If there are any doubts or questions, please get back to us. Thank you so much, Sairam.